الذي خلق السماوات والأرض وجعل الظلمات والنور ثم الذين كفروا بربهم يعدلون وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله بشر وأنذر لا خير إلا دل الأمة عليه ولا شر إلا حذرها منه فصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن اهتدى بهداه إلى يوم الدين نسأل الله جل وعلا أن يبصرنا بالحق وأن يمن علينا بالالتزام به والثبات عليه حتى يتوفانا وهو راض عنا اللهم إنا نسألك علما نافعا وقلبا خاشعا وعملا متقبلا اللهم اجعل تجمعنا هذا تجمعا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما ولا تجعل فينا شقيا ولا محروما اللهم إنا نعوذ بك أن نضل أو نضل أو نزل أو نزل أو نظلم أو نظلم أو نجهل أو يجهل علينا اللهم آمين. All praise is due to Allah. We praise Him. We seek His assistance. We worship Him. And we seek His tawfiq. And we pray to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach us that which is beneficial to us. فَإِنَّهُ مَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ. And we pray to Allah Azza wa Jal to show us that which is haqq as haqq and give us the tawfiq to follow it. And to show us that which is falsehood as falsehood and give us the tawfiq to avoid it. And we pray to Allah Azza wa Jal to keep us steadfast on the straight path until we return to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma ameen. I pray to Allah Azza wa Jal to make this night the night of the 28th of Shawwal. For the Hijri year 1438 since Hijrat al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which translates into the 22nd of July for the Gregorian year 2017. I pray to Allah Azza wa Jal to make this night a blessed night, and I pray to Allah Azza wa Jal to make all those who are present here with us in the masjid, from brothers and sisters, and those, well, we don't have online today. I pray to Allah Azza wa Jal to make all of them blessed in themselves, in their families. And I pray to Allah Azza wa Jal to bless their wealth and their time. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to learn that which is beneficial to us. And to give us the tawfiq to apply it in our daily life. Allahumma allimna ma yanfa'una wa anfa'na bima allamtana wa zidna ilma. Allahumma ameen. It feels good, brothers, to be back after this long break. You know, after we broke for the month of Ramadan and then we had to break for a couple of extra weeks, but it feels so good to be back in this majlis al-ilm that I pray to Allah Azza wa Jal to make us mubarak and to teach us the beneficial ilm and to give us the tawfiq to apply it, like I said. I made a commitment, personal commitment myself, to make this upcoming year the best year ever for myself. And I hope that you share the same commitment. I hope that you just say to yourself, I want to make a change. I want to change. I don't want this year to be like every other year, previous year. I want to make a change that is achievable, a change that starts from the inside, something that I can do. A lot of people, I'm talking to a lot of people and even overseas, I happen to go back to Kuwait and I talk to a lot of people. What I noticed is there is a lot of depression. Believe it or not, people are depressed. Depressed because they keep talking about things that are beyond their control. This is happening and that's happening and look at what's happening to us. And all of this is beyond our control. And then they feel depressed and then they don't do anything. They do nothing. They are blind from their own mistakes and their own sins and their own shortcomings. We don't want to busy ourselves with things that are beyond our control, that I have no way of changing myself. We pray to Allah Azza wa Jal to make a change, to change things for us. But I know there are things that I can start myself that I can do, myself, my wife, my kids, my family, my brothers and sisters in Islam, people around me, these are things that I can do, and these are things that I will be asked about on the Day of Judgment. Let's busy ourselves with our own mistakes. Let's busy ourselves with fixing our own sins and shortcomings. And wallahi, when you do that, you will see a lot of khair coming out of it. For sure. Because I can tell you one thing, brothers and sisters. One thing. The sky does not rain change. The sky does not rain change. Change doesn't come about on its own. Change starts from here, from the inside. I have to change myself, and you have to change yourself, and she has to change herself, and the brothers have to change themselves. This is how change comes about. And no doubt about it, it starts from learning. How can that change come if we're ignorant? If we don't know what to change to and what's better? Actually, if you don't know, then you don't know that you're sinning. That you don't know you're making mistakes. This knowledge is what actually tells you that you are making mistakes, and this is what you need to change to the better. To the betterment of yourself, to the betterment of your family, to the betterment of our society, to the betterment of our nation. Ummah al-Islam. So let's not kid ourselves. Let us not hide behind philosophical and surreal goals. Let's start with things that we can achieve on a daily basis. And this is what we're hoping. You know, the Aqeedah is one of the important matters in the life of the Muslim. This is what we start with. This is what we're going to be asked about on the Day of Judgment. This is the foundation of our deen. If the Aqeedah is wrong, or if the Aqeedah is shaky, then everything else that you build upon will be wrong and will be shaky likewise. And Imam Abu Jaafar, like I said, rahimahullah ta'ala, and jazahullah khayr al-jaza on our behalf, he penned down and he authored and he said, and he put it on paper, in ink and on paper, he penned down the set of beliefs that Imam Abu Hanif al-Nu'man, rahimahullah ta'ala, and his two companions, what they held in terms of beliefs toward Allah Azza wa Jalla. And they put it in writing for us. And this is what we've been commenting on. This is what we've been studying. Because this is what Allah Azza wa Jal approves of in terms of beliefs, in terms of aqeedah, in terms of tawheed, in terms of belief in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the rest of the matters of aqeedah, of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And if, for those who were with us, if you remember, at the very beginning, and subhanAllah, it is done yet. Brothers, you should have told me. All right. Let's bring the good stuff, right? So for those, like I said, for those who were with us, Imam Abu Jaafar from the very beginning, from the first statement, he said, this is a mention of an explanation of the Aqeedah of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah upon the ways of the jurists of the religion, Abu Hanif al-Nu'man and Abu Yusuf Al-Ansari and Imam Abu Abdullah Muhammad Al-Shaybani. And this is the Aqeedah of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. This is what they held as belief. And we said that there is literally no disagreement in terms of the matters of Aqeedah across the different madhahib or masalik, for those who call it maslak. If you say I am maslak Hanafi, or I am maslak Shafi'i, or I am maslak Hanbali, or who did we miss? Maliki, right? It doesn't matter. Ahl al-Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they have consensus. They have a total, literally total agreement, aside from few minor disagreements. And we're going to go over, inshallah, when we hit them. But for the vast majority, there is an agreement between the four madhahib, for the four a'immah, and Ahl al-Sunnah wal Jama'ah have the same set of beliefs in terms of aqeedah, right? And with respect to Allah Azza wa Jal, with respect to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and all the matters of aqeedah. So alhamdulillah, there is no disagreement, right? And al-Imam Abu Hanifa al-Nu'man rahimahullah ta'ala, he used to call al-aqeedah usul al-deen. They are the basis and the foundation of the deen. And he used to call it al-fiqh al-akbar. This is al-fiqh al-akbar. And the fiqh that we know today, you know, the matters of tahara and salah and siyam, this is fiqh al-furu'. Right? These are the matters of the fiqh, the branches of the fiqh. But this is fiqh al-fiqh al-akbar, the greatest fiqh. Why? Because everything resides upon it. What? How useful is that salah if your aqidah is wrong? How useful is your siyam if your aqidah is wrong? That is why it is called, or Imam Abu Hanifa al-Nu'man, rahimahullah ta'ala, wa jazahullahu anna khayr al-jaza, he used to call it al-fiqh al-akbar. Al-fiqh al-akbar, or usul al-deen. And this is why we ought to actually spend, you know, time on it and to, you know, master al-aqeedah as Allah Azza wa Jal approves of and the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told us about it. Now obviously we've been commenting on this, and I'm sorry, it looks like this is not the final, this is not the final version of this. Should have more. Why it's not updating.
Now it worked. I don't know, for some reason it wasn't working before. Alhamdulillah.
Okay, so for those, they know that we've been commenting on this text of Aqeedah statement by statement, and we numbered every statement, right, with a number. So just before Ramadan, we spent a couple of weeks on the 41st statement, وَإِنَّ مُحَمَّدًا صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ عَبْدُهُ الْمُصْطَفَى وَنَبِيِّهُ الْمُجْتَبَى وَرَسُولُهُ الْمُرْتَضَى. And that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is his chosen slave, his selected prophet, and his messenger with whom he is pleased. Remember, we spent a lot of time on this. We actually dissected the statement يعني, in great details. And we spent a lot of time on this. And we talked about the three statuses or the three maqam of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One of them is that he is a abid. He is a servant to Allah azza wa jal, right? And we brought forward all the ayat and all the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that establishes beyond the hint of doubt that he is a servant of Allah azza wa jal, first and foremost. And this is the highest maqam of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? Remember? سُبْحَانَ الَّذِي أَسْرَى بِعَبْدِهِ فَأَوْحَى إِلَىٰ عَبْدِهِ مَا أَوْحَى. Right? وَإِنَّهُ لَمَّا قَامَ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ يَدْعُوهُ كَادُوا يَكُونُونَ عَلَيْهِ لِبَدًا. And that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم asked his ummah not to exaggerate in his praise. Right? In the hadith in the Sahih al-Bukhari. We also talked about النبي, the Prophet, and we talked about the messenger. Right? And we talked about the difference. What is the Prophet? What is a messenger? And what are the differences? We talked about all of this, right? And we talked how we know that a Prophet or a messenger is a true Prophet or is a true messenger. What are the proofs? What are the evidences that Allah Azza wa Jal sent with them? Or sent with them to be able to tell this is a true Prophet. This is not somebody who is claiming, right? But rather who is a true Prophet. Remember the different types of proofs? First, by the miracles that he supports his, that Allah Azza wa Jal supports his prophet and his messengers with. And we said the greatest miracle that Allah Azza wa Jal supported his prophet alayhi salatu wasalam with is what? Quran. Quran is the greatest, miracle that Allah Azza wa Jal supported his prophet with, and that he actually challenged the people of Quraysh and the people until the hour, right? With, if they can bring something similar to it. And he challenged them from the beginning of the Quran. He said, وَإِن كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْبٍ, and if you were in doubt, مِمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ. For if you are in doubt with what we send down upon our servant. Again, وَإِن كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْبٍ مِمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا. Who is the abd? Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because this Quran was revealed upon him alayhi salatu wa salam. Right? So he challenged them. And then he supported him alayhi salatu wasalam with different types of evidences. Like, for example, we talked about the water coming out of his fingers alayhi salatu wasalam. We talked about the food making tasbih. The companions sitting with Rasulullah sallallahu eating with him, they could hear the food making tasbih. About the feeling objects that don't typically feel or don't typically move, right? That they feel and they show emotions. For example, the trunk, the tree trunk that Rasulullah ﷺ used to make khutbah al-jum'ah upon when they made a mimbar for him alayhi salatu wasalam and started using it, the tree trunk started to cry like a baby, right? Wanting Rasulullah ﷺ coming to come back and deliver the sermon or the khutbah from it, right? Etc., etc. We also talked about his orders and his prohibitions and what he told from the news, right? And then his deeds and his sayings. We said all of these five all together, if you look about it, they're consistent. There's no discrepancy between what he said and what he ordered and what he himself did and said, right? All his preachings and all his teachings, all of them are so consistent. Nobody could prove any discrepancy, and all of these prove or stand as an evidence to the truthfulness of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And then we said also that Allah azza wa jal supports his true prophets. He support them and he back them up and he make them victorious, right? Nobody can come and claim that he is a prophet from Allah azza wa jal and start ordering people to do and order them the with thinks that these are the orders of Allah Azza wa Jal, and that Allah Azza wa Jal give him victory or make him victorious on this earth. Wait, and we've seen a lot of groups who came and claimed that there is another prophet after Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and most of them went away and they disappeared, and those who remain they're just very limited in number of followers in terms of their presence. They're very limited. And we said one of those present or contemporary groups who claim that there is a prophet after Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is this group called Al-Qadianiyya or Al-Ahmadiyya. They're called or they're titled after their leader, Ahmad Al-Qadiani, right? But alhamdulillah, his falsehood was shown and was proved, and his followers are actually very minimal compared to the size of the ummah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We also said that the messengers, also they are, like I said, they are from human beings. So they can get sick. As a matter of fact, they may get very sick. Like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, toward the end of his life, he got very sick. And he had such a severe fever, right? But nothing, no sickness that can compromise the integrity of the message. They can get sick, they can get tested in their bodies or in their organs, but nothing that would compromise the integrity of the message of the Prophet or of the Messenger. Like all of this we talked about in great details, right? And then we said, and this is actually the statement that we started before the month of Ramadan. Anybody remembers this? We started explaining the 42nd statement before the month of Ramadan. We explained only the first part of it. وَإِنَّهُ خَاتِمُ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. This is what Imam Abu Jaafar continues saying. And these are from the descriptions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So remember we talked about that he is a servant, that he is a prophet, that he is a messenger. All of these are attributes of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's continuing his talk about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are more attributes of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One of them is that he is khatimun nabiyyin, wa imamul atqiya, wa sayyidul mursaleen, wa habibu rabbil alameen. He is the last of the prophets. He is the imam, the leader of those who have taqwa, the chief of the messengers and the beloved one of the Lord of the whole creation. These are four attributes of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We discussed the first one of them, Khatimun Nabiyyin. And we said this is actually an agreement or similar meaning of what Allah Azza wa Jal says in the ayah of Surah Al-Ahzab. وَمَا كَانَ مُحَمَّدٌ أَبَا أَحَدٍ مِنْ رِجَالِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ وَخَاتِمَ النَّبِيِّينَ. Is it خَاتِمَ النَّبِيِّينَ? خَاتَمَ النَّبِيِّينَ. Remember we had this discussion. We said there are two قِرَاءَات. This word was revealed to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in different ways, in two ways, right? So there is the qira'a, which is qira'at, which is common in our areas, right? And this is what we typically use, which is qira'at Hafs an Asim, right? The mushaf that we use. He recites it as Khatam al-Nabiyyin with the fatah. Fatha above the ta. So it is written like this. Khatam. Khatam al-Nabiyyin. And the other qira'ah, and this is also qira'ah sab'iyya mutawatara. So from the seven qira'at that are mutawatara, khatima al-nabiyyin, khatima al-nabiyyin. And we said khatim with the kasra, it means that this is the last. This is the what actually ends the series. Yani this is the end of the series of the prophets and the messengers, alayhim as-salatu was-salam. Khatam can come in multiple meanings. Khatam can come in multiple meanings. It could mean the end that seals the series, or the seals that seals the thing, right? For example, you could say the bottle, if you seal it, this is khatm. You make khatm of the bottle because you sealed it. So there is nothing that can be added to it anymore. Khatam. Or it could mean the seal that you put on the letter. Or it could mean like the ring, which is the decoration or the adornment of something, right? The best of it. Now, some groups, misguided groups, they misunderstood, or rather misrepresented. They misrepresented this ayah to mean that Rasulullah ﷺ is the best of the prophets, not the last of them necessarily, right? Why? Because they want to invent another messenger after him, alayhi salatu wasalam. And we say, no, that's wrong. Because although the word khatam can mean the adornment, but what clarifies the meaning is the other qira'a, khatim, khatim al-nabiyyin, which cannot mean but the seal of the prophets. So if we take the two qira'a together, we end up with the meaning that Rasulullah ﷺ is the seal, the end of the series of the prophets and the messengers alayhi salatu wasalam, and he is the best of them. That's an extra meaning. And absolutely, that's true. We're going to see that, right? And Allah and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, which is in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, he said, "Ana al-aqib fal-ladhi laysa ba'dahu shay." I am the aqib, the last, after whom there will be no other. That also supports the meaning that he is the last one of them. And in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there is also a lot of abundance of evidence that he is the last of them. For example, in this hadith, which is related by Imam Abi Dawood and Imam al-Tirmidhi, he said, "And indeed there shall be 30 imposters in my ummah, each of them claiming that he is a prophet, and I am the last of the prophets, that there is no prophet after me." So this leaves no doubt, right? This actually closes this topic beyond the hint of doubt that there can be any prophets after him, alayhi salatu wasalam. He is the last one of them, but there will be people, he predicted. And this is from the prophecies of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam, that there will be up to 30 imposters who will claim that they are messengers after him, alayhi salatu wasalam. And also we mentioned the hadith, and this is in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, a beautiful hadith, where Rasulullah ﷺ said, "The similitude of mine and that of the prophets is like that of a person who built a house, and he completed it and made it perfect, except for a space of a brick," one brick. So it's missing only one brick. It's a perfect house, but there's one brick missing. And people entered therein, and they were surprised at it, and said, "Had there been a brick, it would have been complete in all respects." Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, "I am that place where that brick, and I have come to finalize the chain of prophets." So he is the last one of them, and he filled that one last brick, and he sealed the series of the prophets and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And if you think about it, we also mentioned this before, that there is no need for another prophets. Brothers, Allah Azza wa Jal made and completed this deen for us, the deen of Islam, and he actually is pleased with it, and he perfected it as the last message, as the last deen until the hour. Nothing is accepted after the message of Rasulullah, bi'athat al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nothing is accepted, no Christianity, no Judaism, no other religion is accepted after the bi'tha of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The only thing that will be accepted by Allah azza wa jal is the deen of Islam. And it is a universal message for all mankind, as a matter of fact, for the jinn as well, for the two thaqalayn, for the two both worlds, of the world of jinn and the world of ins, right? It's a complete message. Complete message, and this will be accepted, or there will be no need for another thing, no need for an addition, the deen, it's complete. And alhamdulillah, the Quran is there among us, Allah changed, he will not allow it to be changed or modified. Rasulullah ﷺ, the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ is preserved by the books and by the scholars and by the man and by the chains and by the likes of Imam al-Bukhari and Imam Muslim and Imam Ibn Majah and Imam al-Tirmidhi and Imam Abu Dawood and the likes of the A'imma who preserved this deen for, who preserved this treasure of the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ for us. And the scholars, al-ulama al-rabbaniin, are there. Alhamdulillah, they continue to be there to explain to us the meanings of the text, whether be it. So, alhamdulillah, has revelation. Or that he, somebody has the capability to hear the revelation or the speech of Allah Azza wa Jal. See, that's not possible. And anybody who claims that, he's claiming to be a prophet. Why? Because the prophets and the messengers are the only human beings who are able to hear the revelation from Allah Azza wa Jal. This is actually something that is exclusive to them. No other human being can hear revelation from Allah Azza wa Jalla. Only the prophets and only the messengers alayhim salatu wasalam. So anybody who comes later and say, I hear revelations, we say, you're lying. Not only that, by claiming that you hear revelation, you're claiming you are a prophet. And that is belying Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and belying al-Qur'an, al-Azim, who said, وَخَاتَمَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَخَاتِمَ النَّبِيِّينَ. That's it. No more prophets, no more messengers. So anybody who claimed that I hear revelations or I receive revelation, whether while awake or while in the dream, right? I get orders, I get revelations in the dreams and I come and preach it to others. All of this is lies and falsehood. Nobody receives revelation, nobody receives orders after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And if they claim that, then they are claiming they are a prophet or a messenger. And this is, like I said, belying the Quran, belying the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. As a matter of fact, this is from al-kufr al-akbar wal-iyadu billah, that takes the person. Anybody who claims that or attribute that to a person, then he is committing the major kufr billah al-azim. And this is something that takes the person outside of the pale of Islam. And this is by the consensus of Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah. There is a consensus among Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah that anybody who claims he is a prophet or a messenger or claims that he is receiving revelation from Allah Azza wa Jal, then he is committing al-kufr al-akbar, the major kufr that takes the person outside of the pale of Islam. And like I said, there is this contemporary group called al-Qadiyaniya or al-Ahmadiyya after its leader, Ahmad al-Qadiyani, who claims to be a prophet after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And alhamdulillah, the scholars have uncovered him and showed his lies and his great misguidance, and that there is no prophet after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now some people, this is the last thing that I want to mention, and this is also something that we mentioned before, is some people get confused. Now, brother, you're saying that Rasulullah ﷺ is the last messenger and he is the seal of the messengers, right? But we know from the sunnah of the very Prophet Muhammad ﷺ that Isa ibn Maryam والسلام, will come toward the end of the time, before the hour. He will come back and he will descend down to earth again, right? And he is a prophet. So how do we actually bridge this seemingly disagreement or seemingly contradiction between this and between another prophet coming after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam? We say there is actually no discrepancy between the two, because Isa ibn Maryam, when he comes down to earth again, he comes as the same prophet who was sent and revealed to before Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is not a new prophethood. This is not a new prophethood, but it is the same prophethood that he was sent with and he preceded Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He doesn't come with something new at all. It's not something new. It is the very same prophethood that he was sent with before Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. As a matter of fact, when he comes down to earth, when he descends to earth, he will actually judge by the Sharia al-Islam, Sharia of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he will kill the pig and he will destroy or break the cross. as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told us in the hadith, which is in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim. By him, he alayhi salatu wasalam said, by him in whose hands my soul is, surely Jesus, the son of Mary, will soon descend among you as a just judge. And he will break the cross and will kill the pigs. Not only that, he will pray like our prayer, like the prayers of Shari'at al-Islam. Not only that, he will not lead the prayers, but rather he will let somebody from the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam lead the prayer, and he will be a ma'moom, not the imam, but the ma'moom. And he said, as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam tells us, and this is hadith in Sahih Muslim, that imamukum, your imam is from you, from your ummah, from the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and this is a favor and a virtue from Allah azza wa jal upon this ummah. So he will not lead the prayer, but rather he will be led. And the leader of the prayer, Imam al-Salah, will be somebody from this ummah, the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he's not a new prophet. It is the very same prophecy. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the last one. Any question about that so far? MashaAllah.
How long will Isa alayhi salam live?
After he descends again? I am not sure how long.
Do you know the name of the imam that will lead the prayer?
It's not mentioned in the hadith, so I don't know. Allahu a'lam. Allah knows best. Barakallah.
Sure.
So can you talk about the revolution? You talk about anybody who either have a dream,
you can bring
or
it close.
Dream or a vision or a claim. So what about like the prayer of the calling or the time of Prophet and when the other companion they say they had, they seen the prayers of the calling the same way when one of the companions called for the Allah, what is that? Because they dream about it.
You know, I'm not sure I understand the question. You said another companion?
Right, so in the time of Prophet when a person says calling of a prayer when he says Allah, 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 Allah.
Okay.
That was kind of dream too, but it wasn't to Prophet, it was another companion. Umar said I had a similar dream basically. What is that?
I'm not sure about that hadith. Maybe we can talk about it afterward, inshallah. Then Imam Abu Ja'far, he said, وإمام الأتقياء. About the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is the Imam of those who have taqwa. Imam al-Atqiya. And this, al-Imam, it means the leader. Right? Al-Imam, it means the leader. Which means that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is an Imam. And he is to be followed. He is an example to be followed. Yani he is an Imam and we are to na'tam bihi alayhi salatu wa sallam. We have to follow him, alayhi salatu wasalam. And if he is a leader of the atqiya, the plural of taqwa or taqi, who has taqwa, right? Then it goes without saying that he is the imam of other than those who have taqwa to Allah Azza wa Jal. And that he is an example to be followed, alayhi salatu wasalam. Because Allah Azza wa Jal says in Surah Al-Ahzab, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. Indeed, in the Messenger of Allah, يعني Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, you have a good example to follow for him who hopes in Allah, يعني in the meeting with Allah, and the last day and remembers Allah much. So, he عليه الصلاة والسلام is a leader to be followed, not just as a leader. We say he is a leader, but then we follow somebody else. But he is to be followed. Right, and his sunnah and his guidance is to be followed, and we have to make to na'tam bihadihi alayhi salatu wassalam and bi sunnatihi alayhi salatu wassalam. Anybody else other than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, do we follow him? We follow him only if he follows Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Yani as long as he or she follows Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, yes, we may follow them, but other than that, we don't follow him. Right? If they deviate from the guidance and from the Prophet and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then we don't follow them. We follow Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam because he is our Imam. He is our leader, alayhi salatu wasallam. And Allah Azza wa Jalla says, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Say, O Muhammad, to mankind, if you really love Allah Azza wa Jalla, then follow me. Allah will love you and will forgive you of your sins, and Allah is oft forgiving and most merciful. So, in another way, there is no way to Allah Azza wa Jalla except the way of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. That is the way, and that is the only way to Allah Azza wa Jalla. The way of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is the only way to Allah Azza wa Jalla. And he is our leader, so we follow his way to reach Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. And there is no other way but by following the sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, ittiba' al-Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and al-iqtida', to follow in his footsteps, alayhi salatu wassalam. And this is what it means that he is our leader. And this is what I want, brothers and sisters, that we actually make sure that we understand this. This imama of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is not just a word of the tongue. It is not just a word of the tongue, but rather it is a practice. And this is the reality of saying, he is my imam. This is the reality of saying that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is my imam. It means that I follow him and I follow in his footsteps. This is what it means that he is my imam alayhi salatu wassalam. And al-atqiya are the best of this ummah, right? Are the greatest selection of this ummah. And al-atqiya is the ruler of taqi, who have taqwa to Allah Azza wa Jal, and al-atqiya are those who achieved the highest level of taqwa to Allah Azza wa Jal. Yani they guard themselves against the punishment of Allah Azza wa Jal and the wrath of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Tayyib. Some people went misguided with respect to that, and they thought to themselves that I can actually deviate from the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He is the Prophet, he is the Messenger, he is the Imam, but I can deviate from his guidance, and I can come up with something that from my own. And this is what some of the extreme groups of Sufism, this is what they do. They believe that they reached a high level, right, where they can, and they allow themselves to deviate from the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we say this is a great misguidance. How can you claim that he is your imam, and he is imamul atqiya, and then you deviate from his guidance alayhi salatu wassalam? And this is from the misguidance of those groups. Because if you are taqi, then he is your imam. And if you love Allah Azza wa Jal, and you want Allah Azza wa Jal to love you, then you have to follow the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We said al-atqiya, he said imam al-atqiya. Al-atqiya is the plural of taqi, yani the one who achieved taqwa to Allah Azza wa Jal. Because the one who has some taqwa, we say that this is somebody who has taqwa, who has taqwa to Allah Azza wa Jal. But the one who achieved the highest level of taqwa to Allah Azza wa Jal, this is the one that we call taqi. Yani he went higher and higher in the levels of taqwa to Allah Azza wa Jal. And this taqwa comes in the Quran at three levels. This taqwa, taqwa is not one level, but multiple levels. We see that there are three levels of taqwa in the Quran. The first one is to actually guard yourself against the eternal punishment of Allah Azza wa Jal, which is in the hellfire. And this is taqwa to every kind, every person, to mankind. And this is what is meant by Allah Azza wa Jal saying, Ya ayyuhan nas, ittaqu Allah, ittaqu rabbakum. O mankind, be dutiful to your Lord. And this part of the ayah has repeated three times in the Quran, in three different ayat. Notice that this address is not to the mu'mineen, not to the muslimin, but this is to mankind. Ya ayyuhan nas, all mankind, Christians, Jews, atheists, Buddhists, Sikh, anybody, right? All mankind. Ya ayyuhan nas, ittaqu rabbakum. What does it mean, ittaqu rabbakum? Means guide yourself from the eternal punishment of Allah Azza wa Jal by submitting to Tawheed, by submitting to Islam, to the deen of Islam. That is the only religion that is accepted by Allah Azza wa Jal. So this is one level of taqwa to Allah Azza wa Jal, to enter Islam, so that you can protect yourself from the eternal punishment of Allah Azza wa Jal. And this is the greatest injustice that people can commit. This is the first level of taqwa. The second level of taqwa is where you actually follow Allah or obey Allah Azza wa Jal in the orders and avoid the prohibitions. Allah Azza wa Jal ordered us to do certain things, you obey Him subhanahu wa ta'ala in those things. He prohibited certain other things and you refrain from them. This taqwa is the way of al-muqtasid, the middle way, which is mentioned in the ayah of Surah Fatir. ثُمَّ أَوْرَثْنَا الْكِتَابَ الَّذِينَ اصْطَفَيْنَا مِنْ عِبَادِنَا فَمِنْهُمْ ظَالِمٌ لِنَفْسِهِ وَمِنْهُمْ مُقْتَصِدْ وَمِنْهُمْ سَابِقٌ بِالْخَيْرَاتِ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. The literal translation of this ayah: then we gave the book, يعني the Quran, for inheritance to such of our slaves whom we chose. Then of them are some who wrong their own selves, and some are those who follow a middle course. Yani they follow, they obey the orders, and they avoid the prohibitions, and that's it. They don't do anything beyond that. This is the middle ground. If you do that, then you are muttaqi to Allah Azza wa Jal. That's not the highest level of taqwa, but they are muttaqi to Allah Azza wa Jal, because you are avoiding His anger. You are avoiding disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is by obeying the orders and by avoiding the prohibitions. So this is the second level of taqwa. The third level of taqwa, which is the highest level of taqwa, which is to actually, in addition to that, is to avoid even the minor sins. Even the minor sins, the little things here and there, you avoid them, and you go beyond that, you avoid the things that there is nothing per se wrong about them, but you avoid them out of fear that you get into something that could be sinful. Yani some people, for example, let me just give you an example of what I mean. Joking, as long as it is, yani there's nothing wrong in it, is permissible. But if you overdo it, you joke a lot, and then sometimes you might actually start, you know, joking about certain things that are boundary, right? Now you started getting into the boundary, into the, you know, gray area between permissible and impermissible, right? This will eventually, no doubt about it, will lead you to actually start joking about things that are impermissible. Al-Muttaqi is the one who say, I wouldn't even come closer to that. Those who are heedless, come on man, don't make a big deal out of it, don't make it too hard, right? Al-Muttaqi say, no, I'm not gonna even come close to that. There may not be anything wrong with that, but I'm not gonna even get into that area. This is the muttaqi to Allah Azza wa Jalla, and this is the highest level of taqwa. طيب. And this is what we mean by to fear Allah, to have taqwa to Allah Azza wa Jalla, haqq al-taqwa. Like Allah Azza wa Jalla says in the ayah of Surah Ali Imran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ. اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ. Fear Allah, or guard yourself again from Allah Azza wa Jal. Fear Allah Azza wa Jal the way He should be feared. And this is the highest level of taqwa to Allah Azza wa Jal. Can you give me just a few minutes? Let me just finish the statement, inshallah, and then I'll open and give you, inshallah ta'ala. Inshallah. Then he said, rahimahullah ta'ala, Imam Abu Ja'far, then he said, وَسَيِّدُ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. Sayyid al-Mursaleen, it has two words, Sayyid. Sayyid, chief, leader. And this is from Siyada. Sayyid comes from Siyada, which is that he has preference, that he was preferred in terms of virtue and in terms of favor that Allah Azza wa Jal bestowed upon him. So Sayyid comes from a siyada, which is the virtue, which is the preference in terms of favor and in terms of virtue that Allah Azza wa Jal has preferred to him. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the leader of the messengers. He is the chief of the messengers. He is the one who was preferred compared to the rest of the messengers alayhim as-salatu wassalam. So his orders, and this can be seen, that his orders and his sharia is the one that is everlasting. All of the previous messengers, their sharia were limited in terms of scope, in terms of geography, and in terms of time. Yani the sharia of Musa alayhi salam was superseded by the sharia of Isa when he was sent. Once Isa alayhi salam was sent, Judaism would not be accepted anymore. Once Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was sent as a messenger, it superseded Christianity or the sharia of Isa alayhi salam. And it would not be accepted anymore after him, alayhi salatu wasalam. But for the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, his sharia is everlasting. It is the last one, and it will be accepted until the hour. This is the last message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So his orders are the last orders, and his sharia, set of shara'i and set of rules, are the last one of them, right? Not only that, he is also the source, or he is the one who that they, you know, things go back to him alayhi salatu wassalam in two ways. First, he said alayhi salatu wassalam, ana sayyidu waladi adam wala fakhr. I am the chief and I am the leader of the son of Adam without show off. Yani he's telling his ummah, he's telling us that he is the Sayyid of Waladi Adam. He is the chief of Waladi Adam. He's telling us this. He's telling us that this is a virtue that Allah Azza wa Jal bestowed upon him. He's not telling us this as a show off. He's not boasting about it, alayhi salatu wassalam, but rather he's telling us that this is the virtue that Allah Azza wa Jal, this is the favor that Allah Azza wa Jal bestowed upon him, alayhi salatu wassalam. So he is the chief of them. And obviously, among the son of Adam, or the messenger, the other messengers are among the son of Adam, right? And he is the chief of all of them. And he is the chief of the messengers, alayhi salatu wassalam. Also in another way, on the day of judgment, when people will be resurrected, all humanity will be resurrected, and will be gathered in the place of gathering. And the time will go long on them. Right, and they will not be able to take it anymore. They will not be able to be patient long enough until the reckoning starts. So they will start going to Adam alayhi salam and will say, Can you intercede with Allah Azza wa Jal to start the reckoning? And they will say, no, I cannot do that. Then they will go to Nuh alayhi salam. Then they will go to the rest, to the end of the hadith, right? A long hadith. All of them will excuse themselves except the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and say, I am for it. I will do it, right? And the hadith of the Shafa'a al-Uzma or Shafa'a al-Kubra of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he will intercede and he will be allowed to intercede on behalf of humanity, right? That Allah Azza wa Jal will start the reckoning. All of this is from the siyada of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he said, wa sayyidul mursaleen. So this is one of the attributes of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he is sayyidul mursaleen. And this preference of one prophet compared to the other is actually mentioned by Allah Azza wa Jal in the Quran, where he said subhanahu wa ta'ala in the ayah of Surah Al-Baqarah, تِلْكَ الرُّسُلْ فَضَّلْنَا بَعْضَهُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضٍ. These messengers, we preferred some to others. And this is from the preference that Allah Azza wa Jal bestowed upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He subhanahu wa ta'ala made Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the chief of the messengers, the leader of the messengers, Sayyidul Mursaleen. Now quick note, Some of you may remember that we discussed this Sayyidina Muhammad. Although he is Sayyid al-Mursaleen, and he is the Sayyid of the humanity, but we said that this does not mean that you have to mention it every single time you mention Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Remember, we discussed that. Yani every time you mention the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you don't have to say Sayyidina Muhammad every single time. And even Imam Abu Jaafar, rahimahullah ta'ala, in this Aqeedah, right, he didn't mention Sayyid. Remember in the previous, here, in the previous statement, what did he say? He said, wa inna Muhammadan. He didn't say, wa inna Sayyidana Muhammad. He said, wa inna Muhammadan. Abduhu al-Mustafa, right? We don't have to mention it every single time, and this is not the guidance of the righteous ancestors of this ummah, nor of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself, right? You don't have to mention it every single time. It is enough to say Muhammad or Rasulullah Nabiyina Muhammad or Rasuluna Muhammad. As a matter of fact, when you mention Nubuwa or Risala, Nabi or Rasul, this is a greater praise of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is a higher status of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam compared to Sayyid. Why? Because a Sayyid can actually be attributed to other people. You can say Sayyid al-Qawm, the chief of the tribe. Sayyid, for example, in a specific circumstance or in a specific context, right? That can be attributed to others. So it's not specific to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But if you say Nabiyuna Muhammad, Rasuluna Muhammad, this is unique. And this is a great praise. And this is a higher status that you can attribute to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The last one, quickly inshallah, before the time goes by. The last one that Imam Abu Ja'far, rahimahullah ta'ala, mentioned. He said, وَحَبِيبُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ وَحَبِيبُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. The one, the beloved of the Lord, the beloved one of the Lord of the whole creation. And no question about it, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a beloved one by Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah Azza wa Jal loves Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam like he loves all the messengers and the prophets alayhim as-salatu wassalam. This love by Allah to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is confirmed and affirmed in the Quran and in the Sunnah beyond doubt, right? This is something that is affirmed and confirmed to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yet the scholars have taken an issue with that part of the statement, the way that Imam Abu Ja'far expressed this. Why? They said, although Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is indeed Habibu Rabbil Alamin, he is Habibu Rabbil Alamin, but that is not enough. Why? Because they said every mu'min is a Habibu Rabbil Alamin. Allah Azza wa Jalla loves al-mu'mineen. This is not unique to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Every mu'min is beloved by Allah Azza wa Jalla. He loves al-Iman and he loves al-Mu'mineen. And he loves his righteous servants. Allah Azza wa Jalla loves his righteous servants. Ibad al-Salihin, right? He loves every mu'min. So this is not something unique to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it is not setting him apart, alayhi salatu wa sallam. But rather, what sets Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam apart is to say, and this would have been a better way of expressing it. Nobody's perfect. Nobody's masum. Subhanallah. Even the imma. And they said it would have been better if he said, "Wa khaleelu Rabbil Alamin." Because although he is Habibu Rabbil Alamin, but he is not just that. He is more than that. He is Habibu Rabbil Alamin and more. He is, as a matter of fact, Khalilu Rabbil Alameen. And this Khalil is from Al-Khullah. Because we say Habib comes from the word Al-Mahabba. And Al-Mahabba is a general term. This general term has multiple levels. If you say Habib Rabbil Alameen, this is the general Mahabba. This is the general love. which, like I said, is shared by all the mu'mineen. They are all beloved by Allah Azza wa Jal. But there are multiple levels of this mahabbah. The highest and the greatest and the most perfect level of this mahabbah is al-khullah. And that is why Khalilu Rabbil Alameen is a very special status and is a very special level that was only confirmed to two of the son of Adam. Who are they, brothers and sisters? Ibrahim alayhi salam and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are the only two of the son of Adam that Allah Azza wa Jal took as Khalil. Allah Azza wa Jal says in the ayah of Surah An-Nisa, وَاتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ خَلِيلًا. And Allah did take Ibrahim as a Khalil, as an intimate, as a close friend. Khalil. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us in the Sunnah, in the Hadith Sahih, which is related by Imam Muslim and Imam Ibn Majah, لَوْ كُنْتُ مُتَّخِذًا أَحَدًا خَلِيلًا لَاتَّخَذْتُ أَبَا بَكْرٍ خَلِيلًا لَإِنَّ صَاحِبَكُمْ خَلِيلُ الرَّحْمَنِ. Or he said, خَلِيلُ اللَّهِ. If I, he عليه الصلاة والسلام says in this Hadith, if I were to choose a close friend, I would have definitely chosen Abu Bakr رضي الله عنه. And I will finish by this. I would have chosen Abu Bakr as my close friend, but Allah, the Exalted and Glorious, has taken your brother and companion, meaning he was referring to himself, alayhi salatu wasalam, sahibukum. Who is sahibukum? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam. He was addressing the companions. But he said, Allah, the Exalted, has taken your brother and companion as a close friend. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam is the second Khalil of Ar-Rahman. He is Khalilu Ar-Rahmani subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let's stop here inshallah. And we will resume inshallah bi'idhnillahi ta'ala next Saturday. We have some more to say about this part of the statement, Habibu Rabbil Alameen. And we'll talk about the Khalil and Khulla of Allah Azza wa Jal a little bit more. But with that said inshallah, we'll stop here and we'll resume next Saturday. هذا والله أعلم وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. I'm sorry, following? Following the Sunnah is part of the Sharia. There is no distinction between the Quran and between the Sunnah. Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah. We Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah. We don't separate between the two. We see both as one. So Sunnah and the Quran are both. Whatever Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered, like Allah azza wa jal ordered. And whatever Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forbid, like Allah azza wa jal forbid.